how you guys got started in the Clone Wars series and what your experience was. And
yeah, go ahead, stuff. Kat.
Well, I'm imagining they're very different tales.
Yeah, maybe.
So mine just came through a regular audition, but I was originally not called in for it because I was so new that the casting person didn't know who I was. Mm. And my wonderful agent at the time called and said, you have to see this girl. She is Padmé. And so then she relented, and I had an audition and met Dave, and at the time, Henry Gilroy, one of our amazing writers, and then found out a couple months later, actually, that I had gotten it, and screamed with joy at the news. It was a job I really, really wanted, like really, really wanted. I was saying prayers and wishing on pennies and all of that good stuff. And now you are already like, that one?
No, this is for his setup over there. Yeah, we're getting fancy with two different setups.
I don't even know if we need it, though, do we?
I don't know. Can anyone hear? Well, I need it. I have to be amplified. See, my voice work is only done with like technology where you actually have the skill to do voice work. One of the characters I played in that show was already existing in Revenge of the Sith, so that's
who you also played.
Yeah, the General Grievous character. And I remember I didn't really have an agent or anything after Revenge of the Sith. I kind of just the voice acting thing was really exciting for me, but I didn't have time to really pursue it. And then I did get an agent I got an agent that really wasn't finding me work or anything, but then. Funnily enough, the Clone Wars was being developed in a building that was right by my building, but they didn't call me, so I had to go like all the way to Los Angeles to the agent, and then my agent called me, and because they were asking, "Do you have anyone that can play General Grievous?" So my agent's like, "Yeah, I have the guy that played it in the movie."
How about General Grievous?
The guy, and they're like, "Oh yeah, we'll take him. We'll take him." They're like, "Yeah, he works in the building right next to you. Like, I don't know why you haven't just gone." So then I just walked over to the building. I'm like, "I guess you guys want to use me." So, and then we worked together for a long time after that. But it was Dave Filoni was the director of that show. Who's also the director of Rebels. Super passionate Star Wars guy, super fan.
Yep.
And really hit it off well with George Lucas and was able to carry that show through the 120 whatever episodes we eventually made. And that kept everybody really into the show and passionate to work on it. And that for me was like, yeah, working on that show was just as exciting as working on the movies with George. I mean, and George Lucas was involved with it a lot too. He really loved Clone Wars. He was involved in every single episode that we did. So
yeah,
it was really fun.
I remember once when we went up to the ranch, because occasionally we would get to go up to the ranch to do stuff too. He's up there all the time, but and we got to see a screening of one of the episodes, and I sat in one of the chairs in the screen room that Dave said was the one that George usually sat in.
So, nice.
Like, this is really cool.
That's fun.
Fancy. So both of your characters are so like on opposite ends of the spectrum from each other. What do you think like motivated each of your characters in the Clone Wars? Because like Padmé is so all about like ending the war, and you're just like all
trying
about
to create
it. You're like,
war.
Yeah, more war. Yeah. So what do you think like motivates each of your characters and
hate?
Yeah.
I mean, I said yesterday, and I always say about Padmé that she's a character that really has integrity, and she wants there to be peace. That would be her ultimate goal, because particularly during the Clone Wars, and you see this in a lot of the episodes, that she's devastated for the loss of not just life, but of people's homes and home worlds, which are destroyed. So she would love to see, that end, but is continuously foiled by the deceptive work of someone.
Yeah.
and so I think the things that motivate her are, all the good things. Mm-hmm. Integrity, loyalty, a love of
President of the Universe, Padmé Amidala.
She's a little trusting and has bad taste in men, so I don't know.
Yeah. That's right.
Well, politician doesn't.
Yeah, that's true.
So would you have swiped like left or right if Grievous was on a Tinder app? What do you think would have happened there?
I don't know.
The Grievous is just obviously the opposite of all that. You got to have, you know, there's no up without down. There's no front without back. So you're going to have an equally opposing force. And he was certainly that, and very frustrated too, because I think he really wanted a stronger army. And he kept getting foiled by the Jedi. And I think even Dooku was just, you know, playing him like a pawn. He taught him how to use the lightsabers in a technical manner, but Grievous doesn't have the Force. So he was certainly foiled by the Jedi a lot. And then he had this army of idiotic droids that were there to help him, which I also got to play those guys too.
I was going
to
say, who plays those?
Yeah.
Who plays those guys?
My own army of idiots, played by me. Roger. Yeah. Those guys were fun. So that was just like, I guess we are the opposite. That's funny. We've never done really a panel together, so opposites here.
Oh, this is cool. Yeah. Were there any like scenes, like I know that Grievous, like we got some of his backstory and stuff in the Clone Wars, and Padme had so many amazing scenes as well. Were there any scenes that were your favorite for your character, and you did Numa as well? For anyone that didn't know in the Clone Wars, were there any scenes that you guys did where you're like, oh, I can't wait to
Numa,
do this.
Wait
this
a minute,
amazing.
Numa has
Nikku.
These things too.
I might have gotten some today.
Nice.
That's a wonderful.
Who
present.
Made these?
I'm so
do you know
excited.
Who made this?
Maybe
available.
It might have been Alison Berrios from Cosplay for Jedi. I'm not sure.
They're amazing.
Everything's connected.
So, okay.
Well,
sorry, I didn't mean to stroke your.
No, you're fine. Sorry. You're fine. It's just brain tails. It's
not
cool.
That kind of show.
I know. I just.
Numa is not just because we're talking about it, but the Numa character in the Ryloth arc was one of my absolute favorite things in the show. It's my mom's all-time favorite. Mm-hmm. She thinks Numa should have her own show.
Yay!
And so there's definitely that. I loved some of the stuff in season 6 between Anakin and Padme because it really started to show us where things are going, unfortunately. And just working with Matt as an actor was... Matt Lanter, sorry.
Not me.
Not you.
A real actor. Okay,
was great and some of those scenes. And I loved Senate Spy. I thought that was a lot of fun.
Was that when you were running around on the docks and stuff?
Yes.
I was like thinking about that show. Like, I was like, wait a minute. There's a senator running around with a gun at the docks, like trying to intercept something. I'm like, would that happen in America? Would like Hillary Clinton be running around at the docks? It's just like a different universe.
We might be better off if everyone really did care.
The senators got down in it. Like,
what about you? True. Some favorites?
The Lair of Grievous. I mean, that was one of my favorites just because it was so, it was the funny. I have the little trivia about that. The doctor that keeps repairing Grievous, his name is A4D, I think was actually played by, my coworker, David Acord, who's also the sound designer on Clone Wars. He played him and he did, Paul Lind kind of, performance that was very like it's just hilarious. And so he was supposed to be the doctor that's always repairing Grievous, and funny, he was a funny character. But that show also, I think I really liked the fact that Grievous had a pet in the beginning of the show. He had a giant beast and it was named Gore. And so when he was like coming home from out on his killing spree or whatever and coming back and he was like, Gore, like, I'm home. And I was like, oh, Grievous has a pet. And, you know, but then someone, one of the Jedi or the clones had killed it because it had, you know, it had basically gotten in the way of some things. Because it's a guard dog as well, so they took it out. I just could imagine that, like, yeah, Grievous is probably pretty sad about that. So that probably also got his anger up. And I think, does he have a bunch... I thought in his house he had like some. If there was a table and there was like a bunch of Padawan braids on it, which I thought was kind of sick. That like he's just like collecting braids of all the little Jedi kids he kills. But he ended up killing a Padawan in that episode too. Mon Calamari guy. Yeah, that like yeah. Yeah, he kills the little kid who got too cocky. It's a lesson for you all. That was a fun episode.
That episode was scary. And, like, there is some humor in the clone. Like, I remember one of my favorite scenes, and I, like, kept rewinding it and watching it, was actually one with you, with the virus, when the little droid comes up, and you're like, can you give me the virus, little guy? And he shrieks at you, and then you scream. I was like, oh my gosh, that's the best. I watched it, like, 20 times, so.
There was some definite funny humor. There's another funny episode where... I come back and I say to 3PO, I'm like, where's the ship? Right. And I say, battle droids? And he goes, ah, and I go, Jar Jar? And he's like, mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Jar Jar's back.
I love those moments of humor in there. Yeah. That's a testament to our writers.
Yeah.
Does anyone have any questions?
Questions? About anything? Everybody Star Wars, Clone Wars...
Oh, look over there. Padawan.
Oh, wow, look at that. Was General Grievous ever captured by Padme?
Yes.
No. Oh, yes! When did that happen?
It was the only time I was mad at Padme. Like, you guys had General Grievous, and the Separatists had Anakin.
Oh, when we had to do the trade.
And she made the trade, and Jar Jar, of all people, convinced her to do the trade, and I was like, I can't believe she gave in to me. She didn't give in easily.
That's right.
I forgot about that.
Yeah, that was when we killed Captain Tarples. Yeah. Yeah, that was the closest that Anakin and Grievous ever got to actually meeting, too. Because in Revenge of the Sith, Grievous says,
I expected someone with your reputation to be a little older.
So it's supposed to, like, show that he hasn't met Anakin yet. So we had, actually, the writers kind of struggled with that on Clone Wars, that they hadn't met. So there was always all these scenes where Anakin would be, you know, fighting Grievous, but in his ship, so he wouldn't see him, or that scene. I think they had, like, some kind of thing over the top of Anakin's head, or there was something where he was, like, being dragged, and he was unconscious while he was being traded with Grievous, so they couldn't actually meet because of what happened in the Bridge of the Sith, so they kept trying to creative ways to make that happen.
So close.
So close, yeah. So close. Good question.
That was a good question. Does anyone else have a question?
Yes.
Question for you. When you were doing the fights on Clone Wars, did you always like the fights between Grievous and Obi-Wan, or when Grievous fought Kit Fisto and Grievous?
I always liked it when Grievous fought Obi-Wan, just because they had so many different fights over the years, and just how, I think, I can't even remember if Grievous ever won one of those. Like, no, he obviously didn't kill Obi-Wan, because that would not ever happen. But yeah, I just thought, like, their relationship over time, even though they were enemies, they had a certain respect for each other. And yeah, and their banter was nice. And then, how Obi-Wan had to end it. Obi-Wan killed me with a blaster, and even at the end there, he was like, so uncivilized. I mean, just like that, he had to do that, yeah.
Wave a flag.
That's right, yeah. I know, I caught on fire and burned to death. But
can you say Kenobi for us?
Oh, yeah, what does he say? He says, Kenobi. Kenobi. What does he say? Oh, God, I'm trying to remember that line. What is it? General Kenobi.
No pressure.
Yeah, it's in that movie. Just Kenobi, I expected it. What does he say? It's like little thing that he says to him about... Da-da-da. Okay. Are you a bold... Oh, yeah.
General Kenobi, you are a bold one.
That's what he says.
So you better remember you wrote it on my
phone. Oh, I wrote it on your thing? Okay.
Nice. Question?
Yeah,
I
think... Oh, you first.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, no, I mean, honestly, nothing happened.
But, like, in the past, there was, like, hints of something.
But really, we talked about it, and in our estimation, they had really never been together, really, really dated or anything, and it had been more like, you know, he kind of always wanted to. But she's a little... oblivious about stuff like that sometimes.
She works too hard.
She's oblivious about a lot of stuff, but yeah. But I mean, I don't know if you've ever had one of those things where someone's like, oh, like, you know, that person's like, oh, you know, I had a crush on so-and-so, and you're like, really? that's, I think she would still, up until at that point, mm-hmm. then she's like, whoa, wait, what? So they were just friends, and they worked in like the Mock UN together, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. Never dated.
Never officially dated.
I was just talking to the young lady about Grievous and his past, like before he actually became General Grievous.
Right.
That there was an episode in the Clone Wars animated series where they actually showed you Grievous's lair.
Yeah, yeah, that's the one I was just talking about. Yeah, and the lair of Grievous. Yeah.
And there was a statue.
Oh, there was a statue. That's right. Yeah.
Tell a little bit about his lore and about.
I think when George. When we did the first recording on Revenge of the Sith, I was kind of asking George more about the character, and he kind of told me general terms about it. We didn't get super detailed, and it was more like he was wronged badly by the Jedi, and so he had a real bone to pick with them, and then Dooku kind of took that anger that he had and used it to his advantage to have him be a leader of the Separatist armies. But he was a great warrior at one point in his life, but he had been badly damaged in a shipwreck, basically, or in his ship crashing that he blamed on the Jedi, and so that he basically was a cyborg that all of the humanity had left him, and he was really just out for revenge, and that was supposed to, that statue I think was showing him when he was had more of his body back. Our body before it got killed, and so that was like one shot. But it was kind of exciting to see, yeah. And then I think they even did an action figure that was like an early design of Grievous that had that same look, but it's in an action figure look instead of the statue. Yeah.
They had a YouTube video that actually talked about him.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
He became the
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Was that?
Yeah,
there is now definitely a book. Yeah. Yeah, it's a book. It's pretty cool. That character's got a lot of backstory.
His backstory.
Yeah. I have to actually read that. I probably should do that. Unless it's a legend now. I don't know.
Yeah. More questions?
Anyone else?
More questions? No one in
Anything?
The back?
Anything? Star Wars. Yeah.
I got one for Padme. We saw Padme in Clone Wars fought a alongside the Clone Trooper commanders all the time. Do you think she respected Cody or Rex more?
Oh, gosh. Well, and what's funny is I said yesterday in my panel that I come from a military family. So, like, it was so important to me that Padme was a character that showed that she really respected the troops. I can't imagine that if it were really Padme answering, she would say one or the other. So I'm going to be diplomatic and say she respected them both.
Wow.
Like a real life Padme.
Yeah.
Yes. Serious.
So you got to stand up and show people that. Yeah, come on.
That's
come
pretty
on.
Awesome. Yeah. Amazing.
When you're in the recording booth with Dee.
Mm-hmm.
D. Bradley Baker.
Which clone he's doing?
D. He did a really amazing job of somehow giving each one their own personality, and you know, you could see on D's face and you know everything, just the slight change that each one was an individual. So you kind of knew by personality if you knew the characters enough, and then there were always new ones being introduced that you were like, wow, like I can't believe he's taken another facet and it's the same but different. So I think that's one of the reasons why Dee was already very popular and everybody loves his work, but in this show especially, he just showed himself to be such an amazing actor, mm-hmm. and did, you know, like the sort of pressure to play all those characters and you know, and make them different and unique had to be immense, and he really did it.
Yeah.
Amazingly. Yeah. Like Rookies is another just great episode that's all D. Wall to wall D.
No, you can like just go from here and just get into the mindset of that character.
Yeah, yeah.
be that character.
Yeah.
And move on to another character real quick.
He's Dee Bradley Baker, who plays our, you know, as we were saying, he plays our clones, but he works like all the time doing all different shows. And he actually created a website that's pretty cool called iwanttobeavoiceactor.com. And it's just, it mainly talks about the profession of voice acting and what to really expect about, like, how to work in the industry and how to, you know, prepare your demo and all that kind of stuff. And it's just, he just made it out of the goodness of his heart to answer to people when they say, how do you get into this? And he has a real sort of reality-based website that's not selling anything other than just, like, showing you how to do it, because he's had such success at it and he wants to share it. Yeah, but he's a great guy. Yeah. iwanttobeavoiceactor.com.
And it made it super easy for us because oftentimes actually at events you will meet, you know, people who they would like to pursue it. Mm-hmm. And everybody has a different story about how they ended up here and doing it. And it's kind of like, I'm not sure. So Dee created this and he took the time and did it. And now we just all go check this out.
Yeah. It's like a just breakdown of what it takes to do it. Yeah.
I always thought, you know, it would be like having total, like, split personality.
Well, we have those too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I know from reading to children.
Yeah.
You know, and reading the storylines in the books and then going into each character and giving them their own personality
right.
and voice and whatever. Sometimes after a while you're like,
who am I?
That character like that I was reading in the beginning of the story. You know.
Yeah. That's fun. Wow. Yeah, it's the fun part of it.
Ms. Gaber, how did you get into voice acting?
I had moved to Los Angeles from Georgia because I wanted to be an actress, and I was just there working, you know, pounding the pavement, all that sort of stuff, and I had someone recommend me to an agent saying that they thought that I would be a good candidate for voiceover, and I honestly didn't even know what it was. Like, at the time, I didn't think about it, and then I was saying yesterday as well that it's everywhere. It's, you know, it's in an elevator, it's on the radio, it's on the TV, it's you know, movies, everything.
Yeah.
So I kind of just went in and met this agent, and she told me how impossible it was to get into voiceover, and I was like, okay. She said, but come back and read. And so I came back, auditioned, and she signed me. And my second audition, my first was for Papa John's Pizza, which I did not get. But my second audition was for a video game called Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic.
Mm-hmm.
And I got Mission Veo. And the rest, as they say, is history.
Now, when you're voiceover and just a commercial where you're just talking, it's so much different from doing like a cartoon, or, you know, because you have to meter your voice to, you know. Do they show you like the video and then you're talking along with the video?
It happens differently on all the projects. Sometimes sometimes things are already done, sometimes things aren't done.
Mm-hmm.
So it really changes each time. And like when I'm doing a commercial, I said yesterday I'm currently the voice of the Laughing Cow. We don't see anything when I'm doing that. I just read it. And in fact, I said I didn't realize I was the actual cow until I saw the commercial. And I went, wait, I'm the cow? I thought I was just going to be, you know, the tag at the end. So it's different with each one. And usually we don't have stuff that we're doing it to. Sometimes if you're doing a video game, for instance, that's already been done in Japanese and you're redubbing it in English, you'll get to see what you do. And
yeah, because I mean, like, the voice kind of has to match
mouth
movement.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's one of the jobs that, I also do post-production sound work. That's my main job, which is at Lucasfilm. And that's one of the things we do. We have to record actors all the time where 50-60% of what you hear on the set is not usable when it's recorded, because especially on a science fiction film, if it's supposed to be you're walking around the Millennium Falcon or a Star Destroyer, but the set has creaky wood floors on it, and then so you have the background of the creaky wood and all that. Yeah. Yeah. You just pull it out. Yeah. Yeah, so you bring the actors into the set and are into the studio, and we queue up every single line in the movie, and we have to actually have them perform it in the exact same lip sync as how they did. And it's an art for those actors to have to do that, because it's you have to still be motivated like you were on the set, and then you have to also get it perfectly in the mouth, and Right. It's called looping because you put the thing on a loop and you just do it over and over until they get it right. And
it's also called ADR, right? So ADR stand for?
Automated dialogue replacement, which is looping. It's just you're just going in this automatic form. So we go through and we say he starts talking here and he ends talking here. Here's the line, and then so they hear a beat like it's a musical thing. It's like 1, 2, 3, speak. You know, it's not fun.
And some actors some actors are really really good at it.
Yeah,
and some actors are not.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you can see sometimes you go to the movies and you'll see somebody's mouth move and the words are really not connecting to
The sound, you know, is if it's not right, it's so distracting.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So it's truly an art form in and of itself.
Mm-hmm.
Matt.
Yeah, it's a big part of the job. Yeah, that's George Lucas used to call sound 50% of your experience in the theater. It's just, I said this yesterday, it's like it's a very emotional and subliminal way to connect to your audience. That's kind of a little secret back door that we call it, because it can give larger scope to what you're seeing on screen, and you're not really even realizing it, you know.
Can tell like somebody's putting the wrong inflection in certain places where it's like, okay, that's not really how it should sound.
Yeah, there's
sometimes I catch that and I'm like,
but the sound design and the like for a Star Wars film, exactly, it's we've got, you know, creatures and ambiences and backgrounds and vehicles and weapons and all these things that we can create that are in a science fiction world, so we get to take a lot of dramatic license as to what we use for the components for things. In Attack of the Clones, there was this one scene that all the characters are in this arena at the end, and they're fighting all these creatures. And I remember the background sound of what we wanted the crowd to sound like. We were like, well, what do we make that of? Because it's all, there's this aliens, they're called, you know, these Geonosians that are there. And I had gone and recorded in Australia on that film. I'd gone and recorded some fruit bats at a sanctuary, and there was a couple of them that were fighting over a banana, and they were making all these weird sounds. So I recorded that, and then I'd also gone to Melbourne in Australia and recorded Antarctic penguins coming back from Antarctica to this little Phillip Island in Melbourne, and they were all doing their mating calls. So I had penguin mating calls with fruit bats fighting over a banana, and that gets mixed together to become the Geonosian crowd. So it's that you don't ever think about, like, I'm gonna go record this penguin to be this Geonosian, but you grab it, we bring it all back to the studio, and that's how we create. Like, that's just one example of something to create sound. But yeah, it's fun. In Star Wars movies, it's, you really get to take a lot of dramatic license with this fun. Nice.
Is that how, like, do you just go to different places and record different things just to get different sounds, or how did you decide, like, I want to go record some bats?
Well, we were shooting those Star Wars films in Australia, so I just took advantage of whenever I had time to go and get local stuff that was different than where I normally live. And the birds, I tried to get a kookaburra sound, which is that classic, I can't do it with my mouth, but the it's like a classic, almost cartoon sounding.
Too bad D's not here.
He could do it. Yeah. It's in the beginning of Raiders of the Lost Ark when they're like in the jungle there, and there's those like birds in the background that's a fictitious one, that the one that's in there I think was performed by an actor, but I tried to get a real one. Mm-hmm. And I did, but I haven't used it in a movie yet.
So, holding on to it. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I did. Mm-hmm. You mentioned the dark saber, the ancient saber that while we're on the topic of sound design.
Yeah.
I'm pretty curious how you made the effect for that.
Yeah, that was made, the Darksaber was, what was that arc? That was the arc of, Mandalorian arc. Wasn't that with Pre Vizsla?
Yeah.
Death Watch and Pre Vizsla. That's right, Pre Vizsla was in that too. But yeah, he got this Darksaber that the origin of was that like pre Knights of the Old Republic or something? It was a really old saber.
Mm-hmm.
And it had this black look to it. And so we wanted to create something that was going to be reminiscent of a lightsaber sound, because those are so iconic and everyone loves. But David Acord, our sound designer, came up with that one. And it was actually a tuning fork he would take a tuning fork and record that and make this kind of tonal sound, and then he would Doppler effect it, which is Doppler effect is like when something gets closer to the microphone, it sounds like more intense, like when a train comes by and it's like ding 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 ding, like, you know, like when it goes by. So, but even though the sound, if you listen to it not moving, would be you know, the same.
Any more questions, Siri?
I was wondering in terms of guest stars that come in, who were you like most excited or surprised to see come in?
Oh yeah.
I know for me, the one that like in person was really a big deal was Michael York.
Oh yeah, the Blue Shadow Virus.
Because he's just an iconic actor, and I just walked in and he's like right here.
Yeah.
You know, and he's like, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'm just going, what am I doing here? I'm next to Michael York.
Yeah, he was
like,
great.
He's huge.
I was there for that session.
And also for me, our dear Ian Abercrombie, who was our Palpatine for most of the season, and then sadly we lost him. Again, he was just someone I had watched from all kinds of stuff, but, you know, Seinfeld.
Yeah, that's right. He was on Seinfeld.
Yeah, he was.
He was in Army of Darkness
Mr.
also.
Mr. Pitt in Seinfeld. And it was so cool because Ian was one of those people who had been working in the industry for so long that he had really these stories about old Hollywood and how he first got his start and the kind of stuff that I could just sit there and listen to him for hours. So we had really cool guest stars. What about you?
Yeah, I think the first episode where I got invited down to be part of the ensemble cast to record was I think they were the Malevolence episodes. There was one that had Gnocht in it, and Gnocht was the Trandoshan guy, the junker. Yeah.
The two with the droid. I forget what they called it, but the two droid episodes
where R2 is. Oh yeah, with R5 or whatever.
Goldie,
that's right. Yeah. So Gnocht was played by Ron Perlman. And that was my first day down there. He was standing next to me too. And I'm like, I have to act with Hellboy. Like, because normally most of my acting was done at Skywalker Ranch with George Lucas is obviously still a celebrity, amazing, iconic guy, but I was used to working with him and it was very just like casual about what I was doing. But that first day, I remember I was like, oh, there's a bunch of people behind the glass and there's Ron Perlman, and we got to go through the script like all as a linear fashion. And it was kind of intimidating, but hilarious. And it was funny because I don't think Ron Perlman knew anything about the character of Grievous, because when we started it, when we started recording, his lines were before mine. And they're like, well, what kind of voice are you going to do? And he's like, I don't know. I'll just do like a gruff Eastern European accent or something. How about that? And then he starts doing it. I'm like, that sounds exactly like Grievous. And I'm like, this is going to be awkward when we get down to my parts. But luckily, like, voice changing stuff I do, I make it sound like it's being synthesized through a box inside of Grievous. And I think it separated our performances enough where
when
it,
she was little,
yeah, yeah.
She used to think that the song by Def Leppard, Love Bites, you know, the she always thought that was Grievous.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah.
Grievous' song.
That's hilarious. Yeah. Yeah, but that was my favorite guest star for sure, Ron Perlman.
Nice. Anyone else?
Am I looking at anything else for Lucas right now?
Yeah. I mean,
I'm going to miss that question.
Oh, no, it's okay. Yeah, I'm doing sound work on The Force Awakens right now. Working on that one, and then I'm doing sound on Rebels as well. So those are both happening. And I did some voice work for the Infinity game, the Star Wars Infinity game that's out now, I guess, that came out. So there's a Republic section of that game. But mainly the sound on Force Awakens right now. It's a big deal.
And I worked on Infinity as well. And then I just maybe like 10 days ago or something, there's a new Star Wars game for your phone, for your mobile devices called Uprising. And I play Riley in that. So it's the player's sister. So whoever you are and you're playing, I am all of your sisters.
Nice.
Uprising.
Yeah.
Wheel bike? The wheel bike?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What happened to the wheel bike?
Don't you have it at your house?
Yeah, I don't. The wheel bike was sadly destroyed by, because it, you know, fell off the edge of that wind tower thing, the windmill. Yeah, and it blew up down there. But that was a pretty, that sound of that, what that was, it was a, I'm trying to think, that was a chainsaw. The sound of a chainsaw with, and same kind of thing. We did some Dopplerized kind of stuff to it, like we do to a lightsaber. So that's how, that like, that you hear, it's a sound of a chainsaw that's got a little bit of manipulation to it. Yeah. Good question.
All right.
Yeah.
Oh, here we go.
Oh,
no. Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Ready.
Say if, like, at the end of episode 3, you know, Padme dies.
What?
Well, we think she does. I'm still not 100% sold on her.
If she survived and she got to raise Leia and Luke, do you think she'd be very happy on how Luke ended up rebuilding the Order?
I mean, I think that's such a hard question because who knows? I mean, if she had survived and had raised them, everything might have been different.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, there's so much that would have changed. And, you know, who knows what would have happened with Leia. I mean, she might have had a completely different path as well. So once again, I will say diplomatically... I'm not really sure.
So sorry.
Probably one more question, gray shirt.
How do they make the sound of chewing?
The sounds of Chewbacca?
Yeah.
That was actually a recording of a bear. Yeah, and it was a brown bear, and you can look it up on Wikipedia too. But Ben Burt, who's one of my mentor, he created the sounds of Chewbacca and R2-D2, the lightsabers, the lasers, a lot of the classic sounds from Star Wars, which we tried to preserve over and never use them in any other movie except Star Wars. So you'll like them and they'll identify really well to you as being part of Star Wars. But yeah, that was a lot of this bear that was actually hungry, so he was talking a lot. Because I think that the handlers, they would never do this now, this was in the 70s, I think they were like, well, why don't we just not feed him and see what he... So it's a bear that was hungry. And most of the recordings come from that, yeah. And
we always wondered how Luke Skywalker ever snuck up on anybody
with Chewbacca with them. Yeah, exactly, all these things. And Ben Burt, who was my mentor, who made all those sounds, funnily enough, he's also the voice, he made the voice of Wally for Pixar. I worked on that as well. And so, yeah, so both, and it's funny because I've seen an artist here across from me, Banky, is that her
Banky,
name?
Yeah.
Yeah, she has a little painting she's done, and she didn't know this fact about the same guy who did R2-D2 is also did Wally, but she has a Wally that's painted in R2-D2's colors, which is kind of funny. I should probably pick that up and give it to Ben.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Thank you guys so much for coming.
Thanks a lot.
Awesome. Thank you guys for being here so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for being an awesome host.
Oh, thank you.
Yay. All right.